Hi everyone, my name's Jackie.
And I'm Mike.
We work for the Brisbane City Council Environment Centres, and today we're here at one of our council reserves, the Boondall Wetlands. This is a very special environment. It's a really important habitat. Habitat is something that we're going to be talking a lot about today.
So what exactly is a habitat?
So habitat is the natural home for a plant or an animal, and animals get all of the things that they need for survival from their habitat. It's five things.
Five things, let me guess. They need clean air, clean water, food source, shelter, and also a mate.
We're gonna go for a little walk through the Boondall Wetlands today, and we're gonna be looking out for all of these five things in habitat.
So keep your eyes peeled and let's go.
Oh, wow, gross. Jackie, look at this. Looks like someone spat in a tree.
Ugh, Mike, no, that's not spit. This is actually something called a spittlebug.
Oh.
So the foam that we can see on the casuarina tree here is produced by the nymphs, which is the babies in the life cycle of the spittlebug. And they produce this foam from the sap in the tree, and it helps to protect the young from drying out and from predators until they're grown up.
Wow.
Wow, look at this. There's big scratches you might see going all the way up this tree. And I reckon they're from a lace monitor or a goanna. So up here, he'd probably be going up either to sun himself or even possibly looking for prey. And the kind of food that a goanna would find up in this tree maybe could be birds' eggs, maybe even small mammals.
Up the top there as well, I can see a big hollow. So these big old trees, and this is a Queensland loon, they're really important habitat trees for animals like the lace monitor. Also for possums, gliders, and all kinds of birds that will use the tree hollows as shelter. This tree is probably a couple of hundred years old, and it takes at least 100 years for a tree to develop these big, beautiful hollows, which are so important for shelter in this kind of habitat.
So just behind me, we've got one of our resident wader birds. It's a Royal Spoonbill, which is a pretty magnificent bird as well. Just on the other side of this little swampy area.
You notice they've got a beautiful crest on the back of his head, and obviously that typical spoonbill that you use to sift through the muddy water.
So just across our track is another track, and this is made by termites.
This is the termite mud tube. I like to call it a termite highway, and the reason I like to call it that is because the termites actually travel through what are essentially tunnels. Now inside here, they create the perfect temperature and humidity that the termites need. Also, it protects them from predators and also from that bright sunlight. Now this one's really cool because it heads all the way up into this dead tree, which also provides a habitat for the tree crevice skink, which you can sometimes see hiding underneath the bark. Super cool.
This here is a Melaleuca tree. You might also know it as a paper bark tree. And as the name suggests, it's got this white papery bark. This tree has an extended flowering period, which attracts plenty of pollinators, things like our honey eaters, bees, and bats as well. It provides a lot of shelter for our hollow-bearing species, but also lots of insects that like to hide underneath the bark. This tree would have had a lot of traditional Aboriginal uses, very important for this area and region.
Thank you.
There is an incredible amount of diversity with the shorebirds that live here at the Boondall Wetlands and also down at the mudflats at Nudgee Beach. All of the species that live around here have unique adaptations or features that enable them to survive in this particular environment. As you can see here, each of the different species of shorebirds has unique beak adaptations that enable them to feed on different food. Some are feeding on shrimp right down deep in the sand and the mud, whereas others are feeding on crabs at different depths within the mud themselves. So the unique beak adaptations means that each species is feeding on a different type of food and not competing with each other for the same food.
We're really fortunate. We've had so much rain in the last few weeks and it's an absolute frog frenzy. Here at Boondall Wetlands, at the moment, you can see green tree frogs, striped marsh frogs, and all different types of frogs. Sometimes they can be really tricky to spot. You might need to listen with your ears to hear them, or you might look in little hidey holes. This here is a green tree frog. It's Australia's most recognisable frog because of its large size. They can grow up to 11 centimetres and usually because of their green colour. Now you can find this frog in a variety of different types of habitats, including here at the wetlands, in swamplands, but also sometimes in our very own backyards. During the day, they like to hide because they are nocturnal, so you'll often find them in little hidey holes, underneath rocks, sometimes in hollows as well. Then at night time, they'll come out searching for food. So they love to eat things like crickets, cockroaches, sometimes bats, and also mice as well. This frog is called a striped marsh frog. It's one of the more common frogs that you can find here across Brisbane. Unfortunately, it does get confused a lot of the time with the cane toad. It looks a little bit different because this frog lays a little bit lower to the ground, whereas a cane toad has a more upright body and has those big glands on the back of their head. This frog also has more predominant eyes as well. So there's a few key differences to tell apart striped marsh frog from the cane toad.
So this is a great example of an arboreal termite nest, which is obviously habitat for termites themselves, but also for other species as well. This particular one has a big hole that's been drilled into it, and most likely a kookaburra has actually nested inside the termite nest there. Possums will also use the termite nest for their home as well. Sometimes goannas get up in there as well. Well, thanks for joining us today on our adventure through the Boondall Wetlands, where we've learned so much about habitats and the unique plants and animals that call this area their home.
That's it. Do you remember the five important things that make up a habitat? How about you, Jackie? Do you remember the five things that make up a habitat?
Food, mm-hmm. Water, shelter, clean air, and a mate.
Awesome job, Jackie. Very good. So hopefully you guys picked up on all those today. Something else we want you guys just to think about is your actions. And they really matter to, you know, help preserve the habitat that we have around Brisbane City. So thinking about things like maybe when you go for a walk, keep your dog on a leash so it's not chasing any wildlife.
Maybe pick up rubbish if you see any and make sure you put your rubbish into the bin where it belongs.
Thanks for coming, guys, and we hopefully will see you guys in the future.
Come and visit us at the Boondall Wetlands Environment Centre. Bye.
Catch ya.